brought to you by King's Cannabis. And this is Sports Talk with yours truly, Denise Harris. And we'll be right back with the AFC NFC Championship Games. Are you ready?
Just a young gun with a quick fuse. I was uptight, wanna let loose. I was dreaming of bigger things and wanna leave my old life behind. Not a yes sir, not a follower. Fit the box, fit the mold, have a seat in the foyer. Take a number. I was lightning before the thunder.
Thunder, 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 thunder,
thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder,
thunder,
thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder. Thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder. Thunder, thunder, thunder.
Were laughing in my classes while I was scheming for the masses. Who do you think you are? Dreaming about being a big star. They say you're basic, they say you're easy. You're always riding in the backseat. Now I'm smiling from the stage while you were clapping.
Why I say who that? They wanna need a room for their team, but I don't do that. that.
I'm standing here jumping, my adrenaline pumping, my heartbeat thumping, I'm ready to do something. Don't sound like a 757 taking off. Black and gold boys ready and we bout to break them all. And even though we playing, it's real, it's not a game. Every time we hit the field, we feel like we trying to get fame. You see that flaw, Denise? You best be alone. I even got one custom cut off in my
ring. To the dome, and we gon' get it on. Bring them to the dome, and we gon' get it on. Bring them to the dome, and we gon' get it on. And we gon' get it on, and we gon' get it on. What you tell them is
man, I've been a Saints fan.
La mama, you a Saints fan?
You know I'm a Saints fan.
La daddy, you a Saints fan?
You know I'm a Saints fan.
Old man, you a Saints fan?
Boy, I've been a Saints fan.
Everybody circling as vultures, negative, nepotist. Everybody waiting for the fall of man. Everybody praying for the end of times. Everybody hoping they could be the one. I was born to burn, I was born for this.
Whip, whip, run me like a racehorse. Pull me like a ripcord. Break me down and build me up. I wanna be the slip, slip. Word upon your lip, lip. Better than you rip.
Break me down and build me up.
Whatever it takes.
Are you kidding me? In the middle of the day, step on days.
I do
Okay, are you ready to talk some football? Now let's get down to it. Let's recap the game first, the first one, Saints and Rams, and then we'll get to the controversy, okay? Anybody who doesn't want to get it, you know, listen to me rant about this or what's going on, time to turn it off, okay? But if you want to weigh in on it in the chat, go to Spreaker, go to KBLP LLC on Facebook and join the chat. Let's talk about this. Okay. Saints and Rams. After an overtime thrill, of course, the LA Rams are kind of the 2018 NFC champions and will represent the NFC in the Super Bowl. Maybe. This may change, people. We'll talk about that. The Rams got down early, but were able to overcome a 13-point first-quarter deficit to beat the Saints in New Orleans 26-23. Of course, L.A. completed the comeback to hand the Saints its first home playoff loss since Sean Payton took over as head coach and Drew Brees as quarterback. New Orleans scored a field goal on its first drive, then added another after quarterback Jared Goff's third-down pass went off running back Todd Gurley's hands into the arms of DeMario Davis. Ooh. And y'all know my Saints are the team. Okay. The home team then scored its first touchdown after drawing the Rams offsides from the LA 10. Saints quarterback Drew Brees hit tight end Griffin with a 5-yard pass for the touchdown. Down by 13, the Rams needed something to get them going after another drive looked like it was about to end in a 3-and-out. But punter Johnny Hecker cocked his arm on fourth down and found cornerback Sam Shields on the right side for a 12-yard gain for a first down. L.A. was able to get further down the field, but the possession stalled on a 3rd and 6 when Gurley dropped a pass, which would have resulted in a first down. Greg Zuerlein's 36-yard field goal was good to make the score 13-3. Late in the first half, defensive tackle Sue brought down Brees on back-to-back play, setting up a long third down. Of course, running back Alvin Kamara was well short of the sticks on his third down reception to bring up a punt. God, I love Kamara and Thomas. Gotta love those guys. Getting the ball back at the 2-minute warning with a pair of timeouts, LA was able to get its first touchdown of the day. Goff connected with wide receiver Cooks on a 3rd and 10 from the LA 41. The Rams took a timeout on the next play. Goff connected with Cooks on a 36-yard pass down the sideline to the New Orleans 6. From there, Gurley took in a 6-yard carry, and Zuerlein hit an extra point. The score was 13-10. It looked like the Rams may have gotten a bit of momentum with just a 3-point deficit going into halftime, but the offense came out for the first possession of the third quarter and went 3-and-out. The Saints used a grinding 12-play, 71-yard drive to get down the field and score. Kamara had 5 touches on the possession, getting New Orleans into the red zone. But Brees hit do everything wild card. Taysom Hill, he's just everywhere. He's everywhere. With a short screen on the right side for a 2-yard touchdown, putting the home team up 20-10. The Rams, however, kept the game close with their next drive. Goff connected with Cooks for gains of 4, 14, and 25. To put the offense in New Orleans territory. L.A. got the ball and wide out Josh Reynolds' hands on a creative end round for a 16-yard gain down to the 1-yard line. A couple of plays later, the Saints bit on the play-action fake. Goff connected with Tyler Higbee for a 1-yard touchdown. The defense then came through to force a punt with slot corner nickel Roby Coleman notching a pass breakup on 3rd and 7 from the L.A. 47. But starting with the ball back at their own 13, the Rams went backwards on their ensuing drive and had to punt again after a 3-and-out. Goff was sacked on 2nd down, which put the Rams well behind the chains. New Orleans started its drive at the LA 46 after a chop block penalty on the punt, which is strong field position for the home team. But a holding penalty put the Saints back at a 1st and 20. After an incomplete pass and short carry, Brees couldn't hit his 3rd and 17 target again, and they had to punt. Needing 92 yards to get in the box, L.A. got a huge off-schedule play from Goff and tight end Gerald Everett for a 39-yard gain on a 3rd and 3. Goff connected with Reynolds on an out-and-up route down to the New Orleans 7. Though the Rams set fourth and goal from the 1 yard line, McVay elected to kick a field goal to tie the game. That was with 5:03 left in the game. Kamara returned the ensuing kickoff to the New Orleans 30, then caught a pass on a 3rd and 2 for an 8 yard gain to get a first down. While defensive tackle Aaron Donald picked up a tackle for loss, Breeze connected with Ginn on a 43-yard pass down the right side to put the ball at the LA 13, the 2-minute warning. On that set of downs, however, Breeze threw an incomplete pass on the first down. Kamara ran for no gain on the second down, and Breeze fired another incomplete pass on the third down. While Lutz connected on his 31-yard field goal to give New Orleans the 23-20 lead, LA got the ball back with 1:41 left and a timeout. Goff connected with Reynolds over the middle, setting up LA at its own 44-yard line. He hit Cooks to set up a 3rd and 3, and they followed that by connecting with an open Robert Woods for a 16-yard gain to the New Orleans 33. McVay used his last timeout with 45 seconds left following Woods' catch. There was a short completion to Gurley and a rush incomplete pass on a 3rd and 7. Zerline nailed a 48-yard field goal to tie the game. The Saints elected to take a knee after receiving the kickoff. There was only 15 seconds left. And the game, of course, went into overtime. With Kamara taking the ball out of the end zone to the 26-yard line on the kickoff, the Saints got a first down with a pass interference penalty. But then the Rams got their first takeaway of the day on a 2nd and 16 from New Orleans, following a 60-yard TFL by Donald. Fowler came in and hit Breeze to force an errant pass. Safety John Johnson was there to intercept the floating pass, giving the Rams the ball. Goff began the overtime period with a 12-yard completion. After Anderson got stuffed on a run play, Goff completed another pass, just like the last day he'd be for a 6-yard gain. After an incompletion on 3rd down, Zerline was set up for a 57-yard field goal to send the Rams to Atlanta. Let's see. There's a lot of controversy here. That was basically a recap of the game. Did the Rams really win? Let's see what's going on with that. This is kind of crazy. Kind of crazy stuff going on here. I personally... we're going to get into the officiating in a little while, but again, the officiating sucked. I'm sorry, but again, this is not the first game that the officiating has sucked. It's been an all-season problem, okay? The NFL is being sued, number one. Ticket season holders filed a lawsuit against the NFL on Tuesday, asking a Louisiana state court judge to order Commissioner Roger Goodell to invoke an obscure rule that could force the final moments of Sunday's NFC Championship game to be replayed. I want you guys to weigh in on this, because this is something that needs to be addressed. The Rams defensive back, Nickel Robey Coleman, hit Saints receiver Tommy Lee Lewis before the ball even got to him. While Drew Brees' pass was in the air with fewer than 2 minutes remaining in the tie game. A flag for pass interference should have been given for the Saints' first down and enabled them to run down the clock before kicking a potential game-winning field goal. Instead, there was no call. New Orleans kicked a go-ahead field goal to take a 23-20 lead with 1:41 left. Again, the Rams responded with one of their own and went on to win in overtime. Robey Coleman later admitted to reporters his hit on Lewis constituted pass interference, while Saints head coach Sean Payton said the NFL office acknowledged the missed call. They acknowledged that it was a bad call after the game. Are you freaking kidding me? Referee Bill Vinovich told the pool reporter that the play in question was a judgment call by the officials. Yeah, okay. According to Rule 7, now listen, according to Rule 17, Section 2, Article 1 of the NFL Rulebook, the league commissioner has the sole authority to investigate and take appropriate disciplinary and or corrective measures if any club action, non-participant interference, or a calamity occurs in an NFL game, which the commissioner deems so extraordinarily unfair are outside the accepted tactics encountered in a pro football, that such action has a major effect on the result of the game. And this does include reversal of a game's result or the rescheduling of a game in its entirety from the point when the act occurred. Okay. Why is there a rule if it's not going to be implemented? Asked attorney Frank D'Amico, who filed the suit in state civil district court in New Orleans. There's also a petition going around. Petition urges NFL to fire officiating crew at center of NFC Championship controversy. Absolutely, I agree. Of course, the NFL did not immediately respond for comment immediately. The question is whether an officiating mistake is the type of club action, non-participant interference, or calamity that merits the remedy that the clients seek. Wow. A hearing is tentatively set for Monday, 6 days before the Rams meet the New England Patriots. This is totally insane. That was I have watched that particular play at least 24 times. It was a blatant. He hit him before the ball got there. That is pass interference, people. It was blatant. It was there. NFL. Admits to it after the game was over. Are you kidding me? You had the authority. I don't get this. Why are they letting these officials get away with this crap? This has been going on all season. This is not the first game, but this was an important game. And Sean Payton, I thought he was going to go over and just deck that official. I really did. It was totally crazy. And to begin with, the Saints got to the playoffs not by playing a game, but because another team lost. That's what got them into the playoffs to start with. That, personally, I don't think they should have even been there. But my opinion only, don't get excited. That NFL rule allows Roger Goodell to reverse the Saints' outcome. But will he use it? What do you think? Should he use it? Or should there be a do-over from that point? What do you think? Weigh in. After all the insanity of Championship Sunday, it was hard to comprehend all the crazy things that happened throughout the day. Of course, above all else, the Rams pass interference penalty against the state that went uncalled and ultimately allowed the Rams to advance. Lingering with that game, the outcome is the NFL's lack of statement about the lack of a penalty. There you go. Lack. And lingering over that is a pretty insane and broad rule in the NFL rulebook. Should he so choose, NFL Commissioner Roger Goodell could reverse or reschedule the outcome of the game. I say reschedule it. They got time. Do it. Goodell could either tell the Rams, sorry, and send the Saints to the Super Bowl, or he can make them play the NFC game again. Either situation falls deep in the realm of the could be, but unlikely. But there's a Rule 17, Section 2, Article 1. It does exist. Noted by Pro Football Talk's Mike Florio, it does exist. And we did read it. With Nickel Robey Coleman admitting he was trying to tackle Tommy Lee Lewis because he was beat for the touchdown, qualify under extraordinarily unfair? You can certainly make the case for the Saints winning if the flag was thrown. They would have taken a knee or went straight up the middle until there was minimal time on the clock. So, if NFL decided they did qualify, Goodell, the rule book continues, could change history. The commissioner's powers under this section 2 include the reversal of a game's result or rescheduling of a game, either from the beginning or from the point at which the extraordinary act occurred. So he could actually say, to replay the game from the penalty on. I don't know. Much more likely, probably, this is what's going to happen, which does not solve the issue as far as I'm concerned. As Florio reported on Sunday night, issuing a public apology to the Saints and hitting the refs who caused the issue with a suspension. Fire them all. or some form of punishment for missing the call. Wah, wah, wah. No, that does not remedy the problem. All that's doing is putting a Band-Aid on it. Gee, this is what we did. Gee, thanks. Then the NFL will move forward and try to find a fix for the issue. Personally, quit worrying about paying all these big-name people, okay? Put some money into the training of these officials. Make some of these officials full-time, especially the ones that have been there for years and call these important games. They need to train these officials more. Apparently, they're not getting it. And they need to fix the issue in so much that a league depending on the eyesight of sixty-year-olds, instead of technology and its billions of dollars in revenue to determine the outcomes of games, can find a fix. Come on now, exactly. According to Saints coach Sean Payton, he spent roughly 5 minutes berating the refs in the game. He spoke to the league after the game and got an apology from someone. excuse me, still fighting this. And I quote, just getting off the phone with the league office, they blew the call, Payton said following the loss. That call puts it first and 10, and we only needed three plays. It's a game-changing call. That's where it's at. So it's disappointing. For a call like that not to be made is hard to swallow. Absolutely. They didn't lose strictly on that no-call pass interference, but the no-call did not help. They probably would have kicked a field goal to avoid overtime. So, instead, the Saints and their coaches and their fans are sitting around wondering what could have happened for this special team and looking forward to the refs when they try to place blame. Oh, this is going to be good. On the bright side, the option to have Roger Goodell completely flip the outcome of the game exists. We shall see what we shall see. Should Roger Goodell force the Saints and Rams to replay the NFC Championship game? Weigh in. Personally, I think that's a fair way to go. We'll see who wins. And have some of the better officials call the game. There are some out there, yes. But this has been, again, another season-long problem. How many bad calls have there been? Oh, my God. Helmet-to-helmet calls. We went over this at one point on Sports Talk where they said they weren't going to call it on the field, but they were going to send them letters and fine them. Well, big freaking deal, okay? You need to bring it to the attention so they stop doing it, not send them letters. Are you kidding me? This is a problem they need to fix. This is a billion-dollar revenue thing, the NFL. They need to put more money, like I said, into the training of these officials to make sure they know what the hell they're doing. I'm sorry. And that was it was right there. I mean, watch that particular play over and over. It's a no-brainer. It really is. The only one who didn't see it was the ref. So there you go. I don't get it. And of course, like I said, the Rams, NFL is being sued over that. Over this call, because it was so ridiculous. New Orleans attorney filed a lawsuit Tuesday against NFL to address a blown pass interference call, saying the NFL commissioner Roger Goodell has the power to put time back on the clock and allow the game to resume. And it was a helmet-to-helmet haymaker, by the way. It wasn't just he pushed him down. He hit him hard with his helmet. So, again, come on. Before the ball got there, that was pretty obvious. Pretty obvious. So, I listened to this. Referee Bill Vinovich, now he was a ref there, I personally have not seen the play. Where the hell were you? Were you not on the field here? Did you not see the replay how many times on the big screen? But you didn't see the play. Freaking kidding me. Okay. And the lawsuit is asking the NFL to enforce Rule 17, Section 8, Article 1, okay, which we have gone over. Nickel Roby Coleman admits he opted to wipe out Saints receiver Tommy Lee because Roby Coleman believed he'd been beaten for a touchdown. Really? Then you should have been called for it, right? This is an unfair act, obviously. He admitted it. The NFL league has admitted it. Now fix it. It's real simple. Fix it. Don't sweep it under the rug. Don't, you know, suspend them or wham them, put them in a corner, so to speak, and apologize. That doesn't fix it. Absolutely not. I don't know. Maybe the league realizes that depending on specific words chosen, Rule 17 could be kicked open. I don't know. A Lafayette law firm separately has informed the NFL that litigation over the game's outcome may be imminent. Ooh. Allowing the status quo to stand is a black eye in the history and integrity of the game, which you have been entrusted and to preserve and protect. This is a joint statement from the attorneys. Good for you. Of course, they could not do anything, which would be totally, I swear I will boycott it. I just don't think, I think Goodell has to address this in some way. The league has to address this. They have to fix this. Just saying, you know, sorry, excuse me. No, that does not fix the problem. And should Roger Goodell force them to replay the NFC Championship? This controversial pass interference non-call is not over, believe me. And the pushback is justified considering the NFL rule. They really need to consider that rule, according to CBS Sports' John Breach. I think what they said on there was, this is what Breach said. If I were Roger Goodell, I would call a press conference and I would say, you know what? The Saints got screwed. We're going to replay this game starting at the 1:45 mark. The Rams have one timeout. The Saints have a first and goal. Let's do it. Let's put it on NFL Network. And then, boom. You got it. Fix it. I totally agree. This is what we need to do. I don't know. Check out the Pick Six NFL podcast. Go listen to that. It's called Pick Six. I'll put it in the chat. It's called the Pick Six NFL podcast. It's really good, actually. And listen to what they have to say. Makes sense. But what do you guys think? I haven't heard a thing. I have stated my opinion, and I think that's what Goodell should do. Or should they play the whole game over? What do you think? I mean, if that, you know, the Rams want to say, well, that's not fair. It wasn't fair, or that call wasn't called either, so get over it. So maybe they should play the whole game over. We'll see who is best. So, did the Rams really earn the right to go to the Super Bowl? Think not. But anyway, a lot of people are going to agree with me, and I'm probably going to get flack, but you know what? That's just my opinion. Okay. And I think let's talk about the officiating. All season long, this has gone on. There's been helmet-to-helmets that have not been called on the field, which should have been. Not these letters and, you know, whatever the case is. That is ridiculous. These players, you know, are getting concussions and everything from this, and on the field they're not doing anything. That's not sending a message, if you ask me. That's sweeping it under the rug. Okay. I think they need to start, like I said, investing more money into the training of these officials. the calls this year have been totally ridiculous. A lot of them have. There is no excuse. You're supposed to be a seasoned referee. Apparently not. Bill Vinovich, I didn't even see it. Where the hell have you been? How could you not see the play? Don't tell me you haven't seen it. You have. You're just not saying anything. So they really need to fix the problem, with the officials. Make some of these 17-year, refs full-time. These referees and officials are part-time, I might add. And I think that's ridiculous. Put a few of these guys full-time and have them train these refs and officials. It's ridiculous. Apparently, they don't have a clue to what they're doing because he didn't even see it. How could you not see it? This is what I, whatever. I could go on and on. So, anyway, we'll go on to the Pats game. Are we surprised? again, the Chiefs made a critical error. And this is, I've said this before with teams. They gave Brady too much time left. After they scored that latch touchdown to tie it, there were 2 minutes left. Way too much time they did not milk the clock. Clock management is crucial in these games, and that's where they blew it. The Chiefs could have gone, had they managed the clock better. And there's an investigation going on here also. In case you didn't know. I don't know if anybody's heard of this. I did, but that's me. Of course, I check up on everything before I come on here. The wild AFC Championship games between the Chiefs and the Patriots taking a new twist in the wake of New England's 37-31 that pushes the Pats into their sixth Super Bowl. The NFL is investigating whether or not a Chiefs fan was hitting Tom Brady with a laser pointer throughout the second half in Kansas City. You can see it. There are some shots where there's a laser pointing right in his face. The NFL has confirmed the league security office is looking into the report of a laser beam, which was reported by KMBC's William Joy on social media. So there you go. The laser beam appears to have been used at a very critical juncture in the game. And that, it quit being ridiculous. That's childish. It was because of the timing. Julian Edelman had just appeared to muff a punt. Although on replay, it was overturned by the officials who got enough evidence to prove Edelman didn't touch the ball. Two plays later, of course, Daniel Sorensen intercepted Brady. KMBC reports the later pointer was spotted while Brady was taking a snap on the play in between, a handoff to Sony Michel. Cameras were still panning over the faces of the Chiefs, shocked and thrilled at the outcome. There is a video on it. You can check it out on Google. It's captured by a KMBC photographer. It was the play in between the Edelman punt that wasn't and the Sorensen interception. They caught someone pointing what appears to be a laser pointer in Tom Brady's face several times. They found it occurring on a deep pass from Brady to Chris Hogan and on a deep pass in the fourth to Rob Gronkowski. It's right in his face. That is unacceptable sportsmanship. Are you really that sad that you have to do that? Apparently you don't believe in your team, Chiefs fan. If you believed in your team, you wouldn't have had to do that. That's just ridiculous. And another time on a pass to Hogan. Obviously, good. It didn't work very well, but still, that's unacceptable. Brady might have thrown some interceptions. Not likely they were his fault. Also, the Chiefs lost anyway. Brady is like most dudes. He's seeing random green flashes when he's walking around all day and not worrying about it. Of course, did you know this is not the first time the NFL has battled a laser pointer in the stands on a nationally televised game? Excuse me, goodness, I wish this would go away already. Laser pointer devotees will recall Brock Osweiler and the Texans got beamed multiple times during a Monday night football game in Mexico. Osweiler was not happy about the incident and said it caught him in the eyes a couple of times. You don't do that. What is wrong with people? Why do you have to do that? I mean, come on. That's just ridiculous. Just knock it off, honestly. Back in 2014, the Lions fan hit legendary Bills quarterback Kyle Orton and holder Colton Schmidt with laser pointers during a game. The moron jumped on Twitter and bragged about using his laser pointer. He was caught, oh, there's a surprise, and banned forever from Lions games. He pled guilty and got community service and a fine. Why would you go on there and admit and brag about it? What an idiot. This is why laser pointers are not allowed at sporting events. One, it's an unfair advantage for the home team to mess with them by hitting them with a laser pointer. Two, it can damage the retinas, etc., of whoever is being hit with the pointer. Why would you do that to somebody? Let's do it to you, see if you like it. And some random clown in the stands of the Chiefs game, who is six Boulevard Wheats deep and going to shred Tom Brady's eyeballs because he wants to help the Chiefs win a playoff game. Come on, grow up, will you please? That's childish. That is ridiculous. Why would you want to do that to somebody? Okay. And it hasn't been a very good postseason for Chiefs fans. Andy Reid chastised them for throwing snowballs in the middle of their divisional round against the Colts. They've had some issues. The police said we've had some issues of lasers around the airport, but not at the stadium. But they will investigate. Simply take the angle and a camera shot that gets in the range of the crowd there and zoom in on whoever is pointing. Given that the Patriots won, it may minimize the effort of the league, but there still should be an investigation. Since the only outcome, you need to ban the fan from the Chiefs games because you can't have that. Andy Reid even chastised the fans for doing shit. So there you go. Interesting, right? For the game summary of that night, it was a good game. It was a good game. But again, the biggest mistake these opponents make against the Patriots, they give them too much time left on the clock. And that was their mistake. They got the touchdown. There were 2 minutes left. And Brady is at his best in the two-minute drill. We all know this. They went into overtime, but they got the ball and went in. But you don't do that. It was crazy, crazy, crazy. So crazy. It was a good game, though. It really was. But Mahomes, I just think that's a rookie mistake and not clock management. That's all. That's all it is. And Mahomes will get it. He will. With a 37-31 overtime win over Patrick Mahomes and the Chiefs, the Patriots, the greatest superpower the AFC has ever known, are going back to the Super Bowl for a third straight season. They'll seek their third championship. Rams, you're going down. If they do not fix the issue, if the Rams do go to the Super Bowl, they're going to get beat. So that's all there is to it. And the rain isn't over quite yet. Even in a so-called down season, the Patriots are the best the AFC has to offer. Why would you bet against them in the Super Bowl? I don't know. They'll face the Rams. I don't think they threaten them at all. They just survived arguably the toughest test of their reign. The Chiefs pushed the Patriots to the brink, but they found a way to overcome the strongest would-be usurper yet. After an uneventful, methodical, by design, first half, the game awakened in the second half. Before halftime, only 14 points were scored, all by the Pats. After halftime, 54 points were scored. But the first half mattered. It mattered because when the Patriots built themselves a 14-point lead, a cushion against the unstoppable machine known as Mahomes, of course, they needed every point to hold off Mahomes in the end. And that's what got him into overtime. Fittingly, to gain an early lead over the high-flying Chiefs, the Patriots turned back the clock. While the rest of the league, with the Chiefs at the forefront of the revolution, they adopted exotic passing attacks that has moved the NFL into an era of peak passing football. The Patriots zagged by adopting a run-heavy offense that has turned Rob Gronkowski, the most explosive tight end in NFL history, into a blocker. And a damn good one, I might add. He had some key blocks in that game. And Brady into a handoff or check downer and third down passer. And their method of attack worked. The Patriots came out with the perfect game plan and executed it. They played keep away from the Chiefs with a run-heavy approach, mainly with rookie Sony Michel. Oh, he's great. He rushed for 113 yards and 2 touchdowns. They milked the clock, dumped the ball off with James White, converted key third downs, 13 of 19, and ran some more clock. 43 minutes, 59 seconds to 20 minutes, 53 seconds. That's double. It's clock management. Mahomes will get it. It's just a rookie mistake. It really is. That's all it is. They started the game with a 15-play, 80-yard touchdown, and that took more than half of the first quarter. It's that clock management. At the end of the first quarter, the Patriots had outgained the Chiefs 119 to their minus 11 yards. That was pretty bad. So the Chiefs did not play their best ball in the first half, obviously. They ended the first half with an 8-play, 90-yard drive that broke through the end zone and left no time for the Chiefs to score any points. At halftime, the Patriots led 14-0, owned a 245-yard to 32-yard advantage in yards, yes, and a 12-plus minute advantage in time possession. Mahomes was 4 out of 8 for 65 yards and 1 missed touchdown. The Chiefs had to run 16 total plays. And the Patriots picked up 16 first downs. And the game was unfolding exactly as they had foreseen. But it doesn't matter how good a coach or game plan is, because at some point, and I agree, Mahomes will break through. They're slowing him down, but there's no entirely stopping him. He came out firing in the second half. On the Chiefs' first series of the third quarter, they faced an early 3rd-and-2 from their own 34. 2 plays later, the Chiefs breached the end zone after Mahomes went deep to Sammy Watkins and hit Travis Kelce over the middle for a 12-yard. I love Travis Kelce. I do. I really do. He's awesome. He rocks. He's a beast. The Patriots continued to bother him in the pocket, though, and added the field goal to take another 2-score lead. Heading into the fourth quarter, the Patriots led 17-7, but Mahomes went in the process of mounting a dangerous drive that only Mahomes is capable of pulling off. The drive ended with Mahomes bringing the Chiefs to within 3 points in vintage Mahomes fashion outside the pocket with an accurate laser that both led Damian Williams away from the linebacker and kept him in bounds. With 14 minutes remaining, the Patriots led only 17-14. And of course, the teams exchange stops, and then it happened. The moment of controversy that seemingly mars every playoff game. Trying to field a bouncing punt, Julian Edelman let the ball deflect off his hands. The Chiefs recovered the muff punt, but an automatic review followed. They say he never touched the ball, and it did not look like it. You be the judge, though. They reviewed it, and apparently, the head office there said reverse it. The officials overturned the call on the field despite supposed lack of evidence available. It didn't matter, though. 2 plays later, Brady targeted Edelman over the middle. The ball definitely did deflect off his hands this time, and Daniel Sorensen picked it off. The Chiefs got a takeaway deep in Patriots territory. And they had a 4-point lead thanks to a perfectly timed screen via Andy Reid, who, for all his faults in late-game clock management, that's what killed him. That is what the biggest mistake was. It remains the league's best play call and offensive schemer. If not for Belichick, he'd probably have a Super Bowl already. And they will. There is no doubt. Mahomes is a power to be reckoned with. No doubts there. No doubts at all. Okay, now they just need to hold off Brady in a situation countless teams have succumbed to over the past 20 or so years. Sure enough, Brady delivered. After spending pretty much the entire game handing the ball off, Brady hit Chris Hogan, who made an unreal catch that withstood a challenge for a key first down. With under 4 minutes to play, the Patriots faced a fourth and inches from the 10-yard line. Brady checked into a handoff to Michelle. Michelle ran through a gaping hole. The Patriots led by three. And the stage was set for Mahomes to begin writing his own playoff history. An illegal contact penalty gave the Chiefs a first down. A pass interference penalty brought the ball to the Patriots' 40-yard line. One play later, Jonathan Jones dropped an interception in the end zone. On the next play, Reed drew up a perfect and legal pick play for Watkins for 38 yards. One play later, the Chiefs retook the lead. The only problem? Again, this is what I said at the beginning. They left Brady with too much time. That is the biggest mistake teams make. They leave Brady with too much time. They know what he can do. And he quickly took them into Chiefs territory, which is where the Chiefs foolishly decided to give Brady extra chances. With under a minute left, Brady was picked off after his pass went through Gronk's hands, but Dee Ford got flagged for offsides. And that they hurt themselves. He was offsides. It negated, negated the interception, of course. On the next play, Gronk redeemed himself, coming down with Brady's jump ball at the 4-yard line for 25 yards. Rex Burkhead pounded the ball into the end zone with 39 seconds left, and that gave the Patriots a 3-point lead. Could Mahomes engineer more magic in 39 seconds? Of course he could, and he did. He sent the game into overtime. But the problem was they gave Brady that chance to get the ball down the field. They gave him way too much time. This isn't the first team to do it. It won't be the last. But you learn by that, right? Mahomes, they played an excellent game. Excellent game. Nobody knew it at the time, but the coin toss would come to decide the game. The Patriots won the toss, got the ball, and denied Mahomes a chance to win the game. Brady made sure Mahomes never got the chance to touch the ball, leading the Patriots on a 13-play, 75-yard drive that ended with Rex Burkhead run from in close. The game began with an unending Patriots series that culminated with a bruising touchdown. And the game concluded with an unending Patriots series that culminated with a bruising touchdown. They're going back to the Super Bowl where Brady and Belichick will chase their sixth championship game together. It could be a perfect, this could bookend their dynasty. They began their historic run against way back in February 2002. And this could be the perfect way for them to bookend their dynasty, which has to be coming to an end sometime due to unfortunate and unbeatable process of aging, unfortunately, yeah. They have got to be the best coach-quarterback duo ever. They provided plenty of moments along the way to doubt them this season, and the Chiefs certainly spent the entire regular season looking like the new class of conference. But Sunday was a stark reminder that come winter, the Patriots are a damn near inevitability. The Chiefs might have the better of the two offenses. They might be more talented. They might have the better quarterback. And they might have a brighter long-term outlook. But they're not the Patriots and probably never will be. We might not see the dynasty quite like this one ever again. For as great and as sexy and as unstoppable this Chiefs team was, they couldn't overcall the NFL's version of a final boss. The unbreakable monster everyone knows is waiting for them if they journey deep enough into January, but can never seem to slay. The Chiefs might be the future of the league, but the Patriots aren't done writing their history quite yet. They're still the Patriots. They are. I mean, that is the biggest mistake teams make. And I said it during the game. They gave him way too much time to come back. And that's exactly what happened. I think the Chiefs played an excellent game. Do not get me wrong. They gave him a run for their money. There is no doubt. But again, the only mistake I think they made was giving Brady, they left too much time for him. and that's what defeated them. So, as it stands, we'll see what happens, what's going on with this, and I'll keep you updated. We may do a, probably do a sports podcast next week on the game before, and of course the Pro Bowl game. We'll just have some fun with it and maybe pick apart these teams. I don't think that if the Rams, if this is not resolved and the Rams go, they're going to get beat. I'm sorry, but Rams, you don't deserve to go, and you're not going to beat the Patriots. Goff, you're not that good. You're not good enough for this. And they didn't get into the playoffs by beating a team. Another team lost, so they got in. They went to. They got into the wild card for that. So, on that note, I'm sorry. They're good, but they're not good enough, I don't think. And they should not. They should not be going to the Super Bowl. My opinion. I know there's Rams fans out there. I'm sorry. I really am. But that's just how I see it. Sorry if you don't. I really am. Please don't give me the flack about this, okay? This is just my opinion. But you have to admit, this officiating has to be fixed. And it has to be fixed soon. This is garbage. This is crap. This is BS. Enough. Fix it. Whatever you got to do. Sorry, you know, we'll find them. Big BFD people, that's my opinion. No, you have to do something. You better do something positive with this. Make them replay the game or a second half. Make them replay just a half a game, half the game. Don't do it maybe from the, where the penalty would have been because we know what's going to happen. But maybe a second, just one half of a game, half a game from halftime out maybe. Something like that. I think it's only fair, and that would definitely show which the better team is. But don't have the same officials out there because they're going to die. I tell you, if I was, yeah, no. Some of these officials, I thought Sean Payton was, I was waiting for him to have a stroke on the sideline, I swear to God. Please look at that play, replay again and again. It's blatant as hell. And they admitted, he admitted, Robey Coleman admitted, yeah, I did it because I, you know, he beat me. Yeah, okay. But you don't get a pass interference call for that, which he didn't, which he should have. But why would you do that? You're just giving it to him then anyway at that point. The NFL agreed. They missed a call. Yes, think, boneheads, you missed a call. Yeah, I'd say you did. So we'll see how Goodell handles this. And if she should stay commissioner or not afterwards. Again, the lawsuits are out. Petitions are out. We shall see what we shall see. We'll see what these petitions do. So, anyway. That kind of wraps it up. Yeah, I got a little rambunctious tonight. Sorry, but it is the championship games. And mistakes like that cannot be made in these games. I am sorry. If that would happen in a Super Bowl, oh my God, can you freaking imagine? This cannot happen in these championship games, wild card games, the divisional games, then the championship games, and then the Super Bowl. This cannot happen during these games. That is not how it's supposed to be. These officials are supposed to know what they're doing. Obviously, one had, I don't know if he saw the game at all, but he was there. But I didn't even see the play. Where you been since then? Under a rock? You didn't see it on the big screen? Come on, you haven't seen the play. My butt. I'm sorry, but that's crap. crazy, crazy. But anyway, okay, done. But I wish you guys would have weighed in tonight. Okay. You can go to KBLP LLC Facebook page. Let me know what you think. Or be on here next week and let me know what you think about this officiating and what they should do. What should they do? Okay? What do you think the league and Goodell needs to do to fix this? Okay? There's no room for these kind of mistakes in these games. Not at all. So, weigh in and let me know what you think. You can also message me from there, okay? Let's see what's going on the rest of the week. Tomorrow, what is tomorrow? Wednesday. I'll probably just play some country music. I had a lot of extra songs from DWD, so we'll do just a version of DWD tomorrow night. Just some country, some good songs to play. DWD Thursday night. Join me. I'm just going to do a playlist of songs from the show Criminal Minds. There is so from all the seasons they've had, the music has been phenomenal on that show, and I just thought I'd share that with you. And maybe some music from Bones. That's another show that's really good with the music. So we shall see what we'll do on Thursday. Maybe a combo of both. Friday, join me for Hollywood Review. We'll talk about, I'm sorry, I missed last week. I'm still, don't have my voice totally back. Well, not after tonight, obviously. I was a bit rambunctious, but that's how it is. ESPN, I'll be right there. Anyway, Friday, Hollywood Review. And after that, don't go away because you'll miss the freaks and our biggest freak of all, Chris Stevens. With his show, Freaks in the Basement. Sorry, Michelle, I can't do it like you do. And it is a great show. He's always looking for new music, and it's always good. So tune into that. Saturday is Supernatural Saturday. I think we're going to do an Ecto Encounter combo show Saturday night. So join Michelle and myself for that. It's going to be great. We have so much fun with that. I think we'll talk about some aliens and stuff. So anyway, I think that'll be fun. That's Supernatural Saturday, so we will do that. Sunday, let's see, what's going on? Not much. May just play some music or something for you. Monday, Sports Talk. We'll be back Monday, not Tuesday. Planet B.O.B. is not on Monday, so Sports Talk will be. So. And in 2 weeks, on Tuesday, join me for TWD Preview. Walking Dead will be back for the second half of the season. Lots to talk about, guys. Lots to talk about. We'll bring you up to date from the first half and sneak peeks and stuff coming up in the second half of the season. It's going to be so phenomenal. And, of course, the Whisperers are amongst us now. So, and they are 1,000 times worse than the Saviors. So we shall see what we shall see. Okay, shout out to some of the groups. True Horror Junkies, Horror Three Ring Circus, Art of Darkness, Walking Dead Freak Show with Jason Boyce and Michelle's on there. Great, great Facebook page. KBLP, LLC, please go there, Facebook. And all the links are there for any of the shows, and let us know thoughts, okay? Let us know what you want to hear, too. Anyway, then let's see who else. Walking Dead Freak Show, Survival Wolves, Planet B, period O, period B, period, on Facebook. Who else? Oh, Conflicted with Julie Kinney, What If Scenarios. She is an awesome, awesome lady. Please check that out. Art of Darkness, Walking Dead Freak Show. I'm trying to get every Typhoid Mary's. Thank you for letting me post DWD in there, of course. That's a great page, by the way. So check all these out. Check out the shows this week. And that kind of wraps it up for tonight. And we're on to the Pro Bowl, then the Super Bowl. If there's any changes, I will bring you up to date on what is going on, what is Goodell going to do. So I will keep you updated, okay? Thanks for listening. Have a great night. Peace out, y'all. We ready.
don't stop, drop it. I'ma make $1 million, then stand on the top of it, rocking it till the day I die in this game. Archie with the fat boy, adding the fire to the flame.
London, yelling Georgia, Euro better suffocate me. Hold it down for country, leave them mothers up to shady. Give a damn if silly sisters think I'm good or lucky payment. Tell them watch it, they don't want it, however they can get it. Told them about that chatter, y'all better go on with it. Infiltrated mainstream, maintaining the same theme. Polo shirts and pig, can't even get them stains clean. Ain't too much I ain't seen. In between LaGrange and Athens, ups and downs, rights and lefts, all around me, planes is crashing. Anyhow, we ready now. The new South has arrived. These savages is finna eat and won't stop till they satisfied.
Let's roll with the black and gold. Everybody, let's roll now.
Roll, let's roll, let's roll.
say they gonna beat them boys?
Who that?
I said, who that say they gonna beat them boys? Because I believe, oh, I believe. Yes, I believe, oh, I believe. Do you believe? Do you believe? Do you believe? Do you believe?
Go, let's go, let's go.
Yeah.
Blue State's not prime!
Ain't no time, no.
Yeah, yeah, come on.
Back in LA, everyone back home!